Hello and welcome to this special edition of Science Monitor. I'm Smriti Rastogi. Through this program, we bring to you the significant developments that are happening in the field of science, technology, research and innovation with special focus on India. According to the World Meteorological Organization, 2019 concluded a decade of exceptional global heat and high impact weather. During last year alone, India saw at least 9 extreme weather events that resulted in the loss of precious lives as well as property, besides the displacement of many. Although the year 2020 seems to be revolving around the pandemic of COVID-19, yet the threat presented by such weather events cannot be ruled out, as India will see a major shift in the weather conditions in the coming months. So the question arises, how India will cope up with such threats in the times of COVID-19? Well, Ministry of Earth Sciences has a major role to play in it, as it has mandated to provide services for weather, climate, ocean and coastal state, hydrology, seismology and natural hazards. And today we have with us Secretary, Ministry of Earth Sciences, Dr. M. Rajeevan, to know more about these concerns. Sir, a very warm welcome to our show. Last year, we saw many extreme weather events like cyclone, heavy rains, floods. This year too, we might face such events, but the situation might become worse due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So how do you plan to minimize the impact of such weather events?
Every year we get extreme weather events. So this year also we can expect such kind of weather events. Starting from May or June, we'll have heat waves. Then during monsoon season, we can have heavy rains and flooding, including flash flood, then urban flooding like Chennai flood or Bombay flood. And later, in pre-post-monsoon season, October, November, we can expect tropical cyclone. Even in pre-monsoon, we can expect tropical cyclone. So these are all beyond our control. So this is a natural process. So these events will come. And IMD has capability to predict these events, and especially tropical cyclone 4 to 5 days in advance, heat waves also about 4 to 5 days in advance, and flash probably 1 day or 48 hours. Large scale floods we can predict almost 2 to 3 days in advance. So we have good predictive capability that so that we can warn these people. But due to also this COVID-19, which is very unfortunate crisis we are facing now, has really added another dimension. For example, if tropical cyclone really forms now and it is affecting a coast, I'm not saying that it's going to come now, but if it comes, for example, this season is prone. For example, Fani came in sometime in end of April and May. So this May and June, we can expect tropical cyclones, especially over East Coast.
Right.
And if cyclone comes, and already we have this kind of precautions and protocols related to COVID-19, for example, social distancing, etc. So these administrators, especially state government and central government, will have serious difficulties in managing the such kind of situation. And for example, we may have to evacuate people and put them in some place, one place, for example, shelters. And even in this will happen in monsoon season also, for example, flooding can happen. And we are able to tell the people as well as the government almost 2 to 3 days in advance. But then what we will do, we may have to evacuate people, especially in the low-lying areas, staying in low-lying areas to a good place, shelters. So this has given an additional dimension to the COVID-19 situation. But I am very sure that agencies like NDMA, State Disaster Management Authority, should be well prepared for meeting such kind of situations. And they may have to take additional precautions to safeguard the people, both from COVID-19 as well as from such kind of disasters. But we should not expect that because COVID-19 has come, we should not expect that this kind of natural disaster will not come. Natural disaster will be an added dimension.
So we need good coordination with disaster management authorities.
Yeah, we have a good coordination with disaster management authorities and NDMA, for example, and also state disaster management authorities with all the states. And NDMA also is responsible for COVID-19 management and all. So we have good collaboration and cooperation with the NDMA, and we are in touch with each other. And whatever information we can provide, we are providing to them.
Mr. Rajivan, can you tell us more about the SNT solution for this?
We have, for example, tropical cyclone, we have best of best facilities, capabilities. We have observations, and observations mean including surface observations, upper air observation, aircraft, satellites, and we have almost 26 radars now, weather radars, and especially along the east coast, so no cyclone can come and enter into the land without being detected. Satellite is looking from top. So we have good observation, then we have good modeling capability, prediction models. We have best of best models now. We have now the best models we have now, two systems, and we have good computing power, and we have all trained people. And that is more powerful than anything else. We are all well-trained scientists we have in our ministry. So we are able to do good job. And of course, weather forecast, sometimes it can go wrong. But in general, we have been improving a lot, and we have now, we are also trying to improve, and we are trying our best to improve our capability. Every year, this capability is also increasing.
So many papers have linked COVID-19 to weather conditions. What do you think about it? Are we also studying it?
I have seen many papers coming out, especially from US and many other labs, saying that there's a lot of good relation between COVID-19, especially the spreading rate, as well as the weather parameters, especially temperature and humidity. And they say that it is more prone where temperatures are between some particular range, but it's a lower temperature scale, and also low humidity. And so they are expecting that with higher temperature and higher humidity, this spreading will not happen. But my personal feeling is that we also have been analyzing this kind of research papers, research results, and we have the impression that these results are not really complete, and they have very small sample data, and because now it is spreading everywhere, and these papers have come when it was spreading over China, Europe, and US, where the temperature regime was very low. But it's just a coincidence. So if you really analyze the whole global data, then only we will be able to get a kind of a feeling that we will be doing it once this situation improves, and all this COVID-19 situation improves, and we'll have more data, more sample data, so then we can have a good statistical analysis and see whether there is a kind of relationship between COVID and temperature or humidity.
Also, Mr. Rajivan, we have seen so many positive developments during this time due to the lockdown, like in terms of air quality, water pollution, etc. So how do you see these changes? Will the outcomes help in making any future strategy in this regard?
COVID-19 had a lot of effect on air pollution. It has reduced sharply, not only over India and everywhere, the whole world, because we have stopped our activities. We have been in our homes. And also it has improved the water quality. We have for some observation taken from CPCB at many places in Yamuna and Ganga rivers. And we have few observations, but the observation very clearly show that dissolved oxygen has increased. And so water quality has increased. And we have been analyzing our air quality data from across the country, including our own network. And we have found that PM 2.5, it is reduced sharply. Some days it is almost 60%. Delhi for some 60% improvement from the pre-COVID to COVID, the lockdown, before lockdown and after lockdown, 60%. Another important is the nitrous oxide, NO2, which is basically emitted by the vehicles, and it's inside too. It's a very good sample for pollution, and that is reduced sharply, almost 70 or 80% reduction in NO2. And also ozone, surface ozone. Surface ozone is not good. It's really a poison. And that also is caused by vehicles and other human activities. That also reduced a lot. And so it has really caused a big change in the pollution level. But we should not expect this COVID to come and clean our environment, isn't it? That is not, it's not fair, and we should not expect. And so we should, but it's a good lesson that, and one important lesson coming out is really we are damaging our environment. Our activity is only increasing the air pollution, water quality. So we should be able to find out what are the major activities which are causing this increase in air pollution. And we should be able to when really all lockdown is improved and when we really go to the normalcy, we should be able to take some policy decisions and what are the things which we need to really control. It's not a secretary as MOES, but as a person, I would like to really recommend for, especially for some people, work from home. And maybe once in a week, one day in a week, work from home, especially people working in ITs and government, some senior government offices. I think we should allow that. And so these are all caused by transport, these are all caused by local industries. And so we can really control. And this has given another dimension to the COVID. If really pollution was very high, it would have added more miseries to the COVID-19 patients, because it would have caused additional burden to their lungs. It would have caused, especially people who have asthma and all this problem. The air pollution would have really caused more problem to the asthma people. And plus COVID-19 will cause another. So it is good that air pollution was kept low. And it's a natural process, so it's a good indication. But then we should be able to make some policy decision to improve this air quality in the country.
Absolutely, sir. The low air pollution levels during the lockdown have helped many patients. Otherwise, the situation could have worsened. So the data collected under your ministry is also useful for studying relationship between the disease outbreak and weather conditions.
Actually, there is a big good relationship between weather and climate with the health. And many health outbreaks, many for some disease outbreaks, are caused by weather changes in the weather, especially weather and climate. For example, cholera, for some malaria, these are the two good examples. It's all caused by basically weather. So we have recently started an analysis of how these changes in weather parameters are causing to different kinds of diseases and vector-borne diseases and cholera kind of thing. And we have found some relationships, but we need to really do much more analysis. And we recently started a service from IMD Pune office saying that we give a 2 weeks forecast every week, saying that these are the conditions for next 2 weeks we can expect. So this may be conducive for example, outbreak of malaria, outbreak of cholera, this kind of thing. So we just started. But as you said, that it's an important area where we would like to work closely with the institutes like ICMR or DBT, where we need to really understand this relationship. But I am very sure that there is a good relationship between weather and climate and also outbreaks of diseases.
Well, sir, we will continue our discussion with you, but right now we'll head into a very quick break in Science Monitor. We'll be back soon. Stay with us.
नमस्ते, सत श्री अकाल। मैं हूँ जरीन खान और मैं आज आप सबसे ये रिक्वेस्ट करने आई हूँ कि प्लीज अपने अपने घरों में ही रहे और इस मुश्किल घड़ी में देश को कोरोना वायरस से जूझने में मदद करें। प्लीज घर से बाहर ना जाएं, क्योंकि ऐसा करके आप ना सिर्फ अपनी जान को बल्कि अपने आसपास वालों, अपने घर वालों और अपने देश वालों की जान को भी जोखिम में डाल रहे हैं। अगर बहुत ज्यादा जरूरी काम है जिस वजह से आपको बाहर जाना ही पड़ रहा है, तो प्लीज मास्क और ग्लव्स के बिना बाहर ना जाएं। और जैसे ही आप वापस घर में आए तो सबसे पहले अपने हाथ साबुन से अच्छी तरह धोएं, अपने हाथ मुंह पे ना लगाएं और अपनी साफ सफाई का ज्यादा से ज्यादा ध्यान दें। हैंड सैनिटाइजर को अपना बेस्ट फ्रेंड बना लीजिए और अपने हाथ सैनिटाइज करते रहें। ये ना भूलें कि हमारे देश के पुलिस, डॉक्टर्स, फायर ब्रिगेड, ये सारे डिपार्टमेंट्स हमारी सुरक्षा के लिए आज बाहर अपनी जान की परवाह किए बिना हमारे लिए वातावरण सुरक्षित करने में लगे पड़े हैं। तो एक रिस्पॉन्सिबल नागरिक होने के नाते अपने घर में रहें और इनकी कोशिश व्यर्थ ना जाने दें। धन्यवाद।
Welcome back. You are watching Science Monitor. Today we have with us Secretary, Ministry of Earth Sciences, Dr. M. Rajeevan, and we are talking to him about the extreme weather events that India might face in the subsequent months and how we should prepare for it while simultaneously dealing with the crisis of COVID-19. So what kind of challenges do you think India can face in future in terms of weather and climate change?
There's no doubt we'll have more and more heat waves and more higher temperatures that can add to more miseries to the health of the people. As also we can expect more diseases. And second thing aspect is more extreme weather, precipitation, rainfall events and flash floods. Urban flights. These are all the two important things which we can expect from the in the future.
So we need to prepare for that.
We have to prepare both in different aspects. For example, we need to prepare very well to predict those events at least some 3-4 days before, enough time for taking action. And the government also should gear up. NDMA, state disaster management people, state government, central government, all should be geared up to how to cope up with this kind of situation, increasing number of events. Heat wave, for example, I will give a good example of heat waves that we have been predicting well. And NDMA, the leadership of NDMA, they have done a good work. And they are licensing with the state government. Now we are able to inform the state government. They are able to take actions informing general public about heat waves. And we are able to bring down the casualties and deaths due to heat waves. It's a very good example how weather service, disaster management authority, state government, central government all work together to bring down the deaths due to extreme weather events.
So do you have any public outreach program to make people aware about such changes so that people can adapt better practices?
We have social media presence everywhere and Twitter and Facebook, etc. And also we go to schools and teach them and students, especially students, we tell them what are the kind of weather events which we can expect. Now we have launched a small program in which we are going to put observations at different schools. We started with Kendriya Vidyalayas, where 200 schools were picked up now. In between COVID came and so we are not able to move. But once this is over and we will be setting up. So we need to really create more awareness, especially in the younger generation, young people. And if you want to really communicate a good message to a family, you tell to the student in the school, go to the school and tell your the student. Student will go back and tell their parents. So this is the message I got it from school. So it is very difficult to tell to the parents, but you can always tell to the students so that they will go and tell. So this is the one good example how we can communicate. So with that we are trying to do it. So we need to, I agree with you that we need to really go out and increase the presence of our activities and also inform, well-informed, be it to inform about
right.
our programs and activities so that they are well prepared
right.
for in such kind of any kind of incidents.
And sir, what is your suggestion to the public to deal with the current situation?
They have to be calm and they have to be well prepared and they have to strictly follow the norms given by the government, perfectly follow the protocol, use these masks when they go out and also keep a distance. And also government is recommending for using Arogya Sethu mobile app, which we should definitely use, and be careful, and also we should not be really panic, and it's a very unfortunate crisis, but I am very sure that we should be optimistic, I am very sure that we will cross over this crisis and we'll get the normalcy will be restored very soon.
Well, absolutely, sir. Thank you so much for joining us. We indeed had a very insightful conversation with you. Thank you once again. Well, our conversation with Dr. M. Rajivan just proved that how important it is to work in collaboration to deal with any kind of challenge. And to fight the challenge of COVID-19, our S&T and R&D institutions are continuously collaborating with the industry to come up with the effective solutions to fulfill the demand of the various products. Through our segment, Science Express, we'll take a quick look at some of these solutions.
Bharat Dynamics Limited, IIT Kanpur and its incubated startup Noka Robotics signed a memorandum of understanding for the large-scale production of a high-end yet affordable ventilator designed and developed by Noka Robotics. Apart from providing support to critical patients, the ventilator has unique features to safeguard the frontline health workers from exposure to virus.
It is really a matter of great satisfaction that in a very short time of 1.5 months, the young team of Noka Robotics could work with expertise from IIT Kanpur faculty led by Professor Amitabha Bandopadhyay and some of our prominent alumni to design and develop a affordable invasive ventilator which meets not only all the specifications which have been given by the Government of India but also competes with some of the best products available in India today.
Indian Institute of Science Education and Research Pune has developed a low-cost, versatile and mass-producible ventilator for COVID-19. ICER Pune has developed this ventilator within 1 month, which is an achievement in itself. After studying a couple of open-source ventilators, ICER Pune designed a hybrid version with locally available and easily sourceable parts amid the lockdown. The ventilator has many features for effective supervision of COVID-19 patients.
In this prototype, there are three primary modes of operation which the operator can select from the front screen here. One is something called the CPAP or the continuous positive airway pressure mode. In addition, you have the standard mode of operation, which is the forced mode or the mandatory mode. And as you can see here, there are a number of different parameters which can be configured by the operator. So for instance, you have breaths per minute, you have the IE ratio, and you also have something known as a volume control. On the display, you can show a number of different parameters as the user wishes. For instance, here we are showing the airway pressure as well as the tidal volume which is delivered to the patient. You can also have an additional mode which is known as the self-assisted mode. In the assisted mode, what the machine does is to try and support a patient's breathing, which the patient initiates on his own. For this, the operator can set lower and upper pressure triggers at which this mode has to be operated.
As you can see, we have integrated a microcontroller together with a mini computer inside this box. The nice thing about this ventilator is that one can monitor the parameters of the ventilator, parameters of the patient remotely, and also control these parameters remotely. One can also use a single computer to talk to many, many such ventilators in a hospital environment and actually monitor the parameters right on the screen of your mobile phone and also control the various parameters through a mobile phone if need be.
Indian Institute of Technology Delhi has launched a reusable antimicrobial face mask that can be used up to 50 times after washing. The mask called NSafe has been developed by startup NanoSafe Solutions and will prove to be way cheaper than the single-use mask. The NSafe mask is a highly engineered triple-layered product consisting of inner hydrophilic layer for comfort, middle layer having antimicrobial properties and the outermost layer having water and oil repellent properties. According to IIT Delhi, this is the first fabric-based antimicrobial face mask launched in India with very high bacterial filtration efficiency.
We have launched a mask, NSafe mask, which is antimicrobial and reusable up to 50 washes. It is very easy to maintain it. After each usage, wash it with cold water and mild detergent and put it outside in direct air or sunlight to dry. After drying, put it in a hygienic place to store.
And now it is time again for a very quick break. Do stay with us as we'll be back soon. Welcome back. You are watching Science Monitor. On 3rd May 2020, the Department of Science and Technology of Government of India completed 49 years of its establishment. Amid the COVID-19 lockdown, the department celebrated its Foundation Day with organizing various online activities to keep up with the spirit of scientific research and innovation. Let's have a look at the report to know more.
Amid the lockdown in the country, the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, celebrated its 49th Foundation Day on 3rd May by organizing online function and activities. On the occasion, Union Minister of Science and Technology, Health and Family Welfare and Earth Sciences, Dr. Harshvardhan interacted with the heads of all the autonomous institutions and subordinate offices of DST via video conferencing and discussed the various efforts being made by them to deal with the COVID-19 outbreak.
We call, but there are so many other things that are happening in science and with our active collaboration with more than 44 countries, and I think the total collaboration goes on up to 84 countries all across the world. And nowhere in the whole world we now feel that we are inferior to anybody else. So.
On this occasion, COVID Katha, a multimedia guide on COVID-19, was also launched. The occasion also marked the beginning of Golden Jubilee celebrations of DST as the department entered its 50th year in the service of the nation. As part of these celebrations, various activities are going to be organized in different parts of the country throughout the year. The Department of Science and Technology, working under the Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, was established in May 1971 as a nodal department to promote research and development activities in new areas of science and technology and to organize, coordinate and promote scientific and technological activities in the country. It explores new horizons of science and technology with a special focus on research in emerging areas through its network of research institutions and laboratories. DST has made commendable progress with a significant increase in the number of incubators and startups. Among its many programs are schemes like AFSAR, which encourages young scientists to write stories on their research work to popularize science, National Initiative for Developing and Harnessing Innovation, or NIDHI, to promote startup activities, taking innovation to schools with programs like MANAK and many more, National Mission on Interdisciplinary Cyber-Physical Systems, international collaboration in science and technology to engage with the best global science projects, such as the participation in the 30-meter telescope, and scientific and industrial collaboration with the other countries that have enhanced S&T efforts of India greatly. DST also undertakes work on futurology and provides support and grants in aid to scientific research institutions, scientific associations and bodies. DST today offers 50,000 Inspire scholarships at the university level, 4,000 Inspire doctoral fellowships to young students, and 700 Inspire faculty fellowships to young researchers. DST is playing a key role in catalyzing urgent and goal-oriented research to ease the challenges posed by the coronavirus pandemic and even to find solutions in the form of vaccines.
Well, that's all we have for you in today's edition of Science Monitor. Do tell us how you like our program. You can send your feedback and suggestions through email. Our email ID is news@vigyanprasar.gov.in. You can also write in to us at Vigyan Prasar, 5th floor, Prithvi Bhavan, Lodhi Road, New Delhi, 110003. We will meet you again next week with new information and developments. Till then, stay safe and think scientifically.